a vlog about the so-called beat frequency oscillator. I want to use that in my medium wave radio, of course on say standard medium wave frequencies. There's absolutely no need of using a beat frequency oscillator, because a beat frequency oscillator has to do one job, say detecting single sideband radio signals, lower sideband radio signals, and CW, continuous wave radio signals anyway. But this is the circuit that I made, and it's simple, there's no problem without it, and it was in my book Retro Radio, issued in the Netherlands, say approximately 10 years ago or whatever, and this is the circuit that I used. I did not use a BC245B, I used another field effect transistor. I also did not use this, say, standard 455 kilocycles block. So, not this one was used, and not this field effect transistor was used. I used here, say, a homemade coil to be tuned to approximately 465 kilocycles, and that's the frequency that I want to use in the IF amplifier. It's 465 kilocycles. I want to make, say, ceramic filter, ceramic intermediate frequency filter made with these ceramic units. That means that when you want to receive, say, CW signals or single sideband signals, it's important that you can, say, use a beat frequency oscillator that oscillates approximately 5 kilocycles to the lower band of the intermediate frequency, and 5 kilocycles up to the band of that intermediate frequency. So in my case it's 465 here, and that means that I have to go to 470 kilocycles and say 406 kilocycles, and that is the whole thing that this oscillator has to do. That's the beat frequency. And when you, say, read radio magazines, etc., etc., there's always the idea that for CW, SSB, and the lower bands, there must be fixed frequencies, and that's completely right. But I use in this case here a beat frequency oscillator that can cover that complete band. So, anyway, this is the circuit again. Perhaps interesting to show it again. Field effect transistor, here a coil, and that coil is made here. You can see it here, it is 350 windings, a pair, and the DC resistance is approximately 14 ohms. Typical, say, wire very, very thin wire. And that's the coil that is mounted here in the source lead of the field effect transistor. Here I write the BF245P, but in fact it is the, I now use the BF256B. It is a, say, kind of field effect transistor that has more or less the same properties. And perhaps it's interesting to show, this was in this case, say, standard IF coil, but now I have had to make that IF coil myself. That's here, and here there are 80 windings on a very, very tiny ferrite rod, also a pair type of wire, and here a capacitor of say 10 picofarad up to approximately 100 picofarad. I have to say, put my camera down to give the very, very precise information about that coil. I noted it all. So, this is the exact information about that IF coil. The ferrite is 0.7 millimeters. You can see it here. You can also use ferrite that doesn't have that exact value of 0.7 millimeters. You can also use 5 millimeters. But the winding is quite critical. And here we have 80 windings. And here on that coil there are also 80 windings bridged with a 100 picofarad capacitor, a 560 picofarad capacitor, a 3 picofarad up to 80 picofarad capacitor, and here that, say, kind of green capacitor that has to do, say, the precise tuning to the IF frequency of, say, 465 kilocycles. And here you see that bunch of capacitors. Of course, I can straighten them out. But here is that complete bunch of capacitors here that you also see in this drawing. Important to tell, for instance, when you say make an IF coil or want to make an IF coil, say we have here the frequency range, and here important to tell that, for instance, here when you have, say, when you want to, say, generate this peak, so a, say, small peak, it's a good idea to use a coil with more windings. And a capacitor of a somewhat lower value. And say when you want to have a resonance that's broader, and that's, for instance, here. Say we have here 455 KC. You can use a bigger capacitor and a lower inductance. And that was in also in this circuit a kind of experience. I made at first this coil of 120 windings, but had to say bring it down to approximately 100 windings in combination with that capacitor. So let's look on the scope. That's always the most important and valuable thing that we can do. The power supply now is 12 volts. Here is the oscillator, the beat frequency oscillator, and I can tune it now with the knob here between a certain frequencies, and we can read the frequencies and we can see the waveform. And it has to be only 10 kilohertz wide. So we have the waveform here. Waveform is here, 470 kilohertz. And when I turn that knob here, I change it to say approximately 462 kilohertz. And say that means that we have with this crystal a frequency band between 462 kilocycles and 470 kilocycles. So that's approximately 8 kilocycles wide, and I think that's enough, because when you receive radio signals, single sideband radio signals, you can also say slightly detune the radio stations, and in that case you can get say the good bandwidth to receive single sideband signals and lower sideband signals, etc., etc. So, interesting to see again, always very, very good and funny to see the waveform very, very slightly tuned for 70. And of course, that's important. You can always say tune such an IF coil to another frequency by say adding or subtracting a tiny capacitors going parallel to the tank circuit, the circuit that does the whole job of say setting the frequency. You can see that here in the schematic again. So you change, do some tiny changes here in the capacitance, the frequency will change, and that's very critical. And of course it's always fun, it's interesting, it's a very interesting thing to do, to say tune that tank circuit to the proper IF frequency with say a bandwidth of approximately 10 kilohertz, 10 kilocycles. Important to tell, I hope that my camera doesn't run out, we have now 12 volts, and when you say align the supply voltage, you will also see that the frequency changes So perhaps interesting to show. I cannot show the precise voltages, but anyway, you see the demonstration. Higher voltage. Lower voltage, especially the lower voltages, by adding, say, a lower voltage to the oscillator, you can change the waveform and you can change the frequency. So that's the reason why I will surely need for this beat frequency oscillator a stabilized voltage. So there are two possibilities to, say, get to the right beat frequency by the way of giving the beat frequency oscillator a different supply voltage, and by, of course, that's critical, by, say, giving the beat frequency oscillator another capacitive value on its tank circuit. So that was more or less all to tell. Thanks for watching. Wish you luck. Schematic again. And the ceramic filters that I'm going to use in the future. By the way, a 7812 voltage regulator does not always work properly with this circuit, so that's why I used here the classical series regulator.